About me reciting the house?
Huh?
About me reciting my house. What kind of person is this?
Good evening. Welcome to the Raleigh Board of Selectmen meeting for August 10th, 2015. I call a meeting to order, and the first order of business is the Pledge of Allegiance. Mr. Gravina, would you lead us in the pledge, please?
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
On our agenda tonight, we're going to have a citizen's query from 7:05 to 7:10. We have an appointment at 7:15 with the Ipswich Raleigh Rotary. And we have an appointment at 7:30 with Conservation Agent Brent Baselak. And we have an appointment at 7:45 to discuss the shellfish constable position. We have general business, new business, and the minutes from July 27th. I would like to remind everyone that this meeting is being audio and visually recorded digitally. And for our first, we will go into general business number one and sign the Mill River Winery Farmers Permit. The ABCC has approved the alteration of premises application from Mill River Winery to include a small grassy area directly abutting the tasting room and a picnic area within the fenced-in vineyard as a part of their licensed premises. The board approved this application with the following conditions. Applicant to provide a sketch of and install a natural barrier around the patio outside the tasting room and present this plan to the building inspector for approval. Applicant Rick Russo reported that he provided a sketch to Ken Ward but has not yet installed the natural barrier. He said he will install the barrier this week. Does the board wish to sign the permit but not release it to the applicant until Ken Ward confirms in writing that the conditions have been met? Is there any discussion?
Fine with me. I give you the motion, Mr. Chairman.
Accept a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
Second by Cliff. All those in favor of signing the Mill River Farmer Winery Pouring Permit, say aye.
Oh, aye.
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 Very much. I would like to respond to a citizen's query posed at our last meeting. We had Chief Barker investigate the sidewalks on Central Street, and he found, however, that there is an interrupted sidewalk on the westbound lane of Central Street and adequate crosswalks to allow it to be accessed from either side of the street. It does seem that, let's see, there is a breakdown lane that in that area and they run together with no street markings or separation between the two, and there aren't any sidewalks typically on that side of the street that you were talking about. But the chief did attempt to resolve the issue by assigning an officer to visit the residents with the sidewalk in front and speak with the homeowners. The officer requested that they park vehicles in the driveway if possible, or to park further out towards the street and leave an unobstructed pathway.
Thank you.
And citizens' query is now open from 7:05 to 7:10.
Go on.
I endeavored to get on the agenda tonight, but I guess I didn't make it clear or whatever. And but I'd like to be on the agenda for next week. And it's having to do with some unfinished business that I requested in my letters. And I'd like to address that. I do want to say that I really appreciate you taking the advice, or the suggestion rather, of Senator Tarr and Representative Hill contacting Mr. Congressman Moulton. I met with his staff last week, and I met with him again this day. He seems to be listening very well, and I'm pretty sure he's going to endorse what Mr. Tarr and Representative Hill has. So that's I'd like to be on the agenda for next week. Appreciate that.
The only comment I will make is that we're not meeting next week. We will meet in 2 weeks. I understand the agenda has been pretty full, but mm-hmm. I will check with Mr. Murray when he comes back as to whether we have time to add you onto the agenda for the 24th.
Okay, well, I guess we won't be meeting next week then.
No.
All right, well, that's understandable. I did request to speak with Mr. Pierce, and I just worked with him a few months ago, and I want to go over some of the material that he wasn't able to, I guess, go over, like everyone else has on the board. And so it won't be repetitious in that respect at the meeting. But I think you all know that the town feels pretty strongly about this issue with the motion they made and motion I made, and they voted on it unanimously. And I'm very proud of this town, as you know. And definitely going to get Obama here, because I want to prove democracy still works in this country. You know, 80% of the town was ignored by President Reagan. And we're going to do what we can to get Mr. Obama here. And I guarantee he's going to come. It's not going to come just because of letters and signs. He's going to come because I'm going to put him in a situation where he has to come here. And I have confessed to the tapes the government's been looking for over 30 years now. And the NRC themselves reported that to the NRC's Inspector General January 23rd of this year. He never got in touch with me. And if I was the NSC, I wouldn't want these tapes either. But I'm going to offer them to the President of the United States. And if he wanted to accept that invitation, then fine. Or, very good chance, they're going to put me in jail if you don't accept my invitation. So hopefully he's not going to want that on his legacy. But, you know, this town has an opportunity to put the town on the map for a long, long time, by asking the President of the United States to come here and address the issues that Reagan refused to address and are still out there. So I continue to, you know, ask for your cooperation in that effort. And so that's some of it, what I'm going to bring up. So, appreciate your time.
I know we don't, normal protocol is not to respond to a citizen's query, but...
I'm sorry?
The normal protocol is not to respond at this particular meeting at this time to a citizen's query, but I feel compelled to make a short statement. Prior to town meeting, Mr. Conley came in and met with us. We gave him the courtesy of a meeting. He came to town meeting, proposed under Article 2, a non-binding question, which the town voted for, to have a hearing here within 30 days. Proposition was voted for. The fire chief put together a multi-page extensive report on the issue.
Yeah, and he left out some real important
things. Excuse me,
I'm
talking, sir.
Yeah, sorry.
We held a hearing. We set up a hearing. You were in here two or three times a week for the two or three or four weeks after the town meeting, pushing us to have the hearing.
No, pushing you to put the ballot.
I'm talking.
National petition on the ballot.
The issue is, we responded within a timely manner to the petition. We held a hearing here, which you advised that it was going to be held. We bent over backwards to have Mr. Ty, Senator Ty here, Representative Hill. We brought three MEMA officials from the bunker in Framingham. We had the fire chief here. We had all kinds of people here to respond. You did not show up at the meeting.
Yeah, I had a personal situation.
You did not give us the courtesy of a phone call about the meeting. And at this point, we've been over, in my 10 years time on the Board of Selectmen, we've discussed this issue many, many times at the Board of Selectmen's meeting. And as far as I'm concerned, we've given you more than ample opportunity. You failed to respond. You failed to give us the respect of letting us know you weren't going to make the meeting after we had all these people travel some great distances to be here. And I will recommend to the chair that we not have you on the agenda, because the town of Riley is not going to make any difference in this particular matter. You've been fighting this for 25 or 30 years. Why all of a sudden it's an issue again, I don't know. But at this point, I'm going to recommend, Mr. Chairman, that we don't have Mr. Conley in, because it's just beating up old ground, and we have many, many other more important things to do. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Peterson.
I want to respond.
No, sir. No, sir. Your time is up. This gentleman, you have a... Okay. We're going on to general business. Road opening permit application submitted by National Grid to open 121 Weathersfield Street for new gas service installation. General business number two. National Grid, Keyspan, 40 Sylvan Road, Waltham, to open up the 121 Weathersfield Street for a new gas service installation.
Mr. Chairman, everything seems to be in order. I'll give you a motion.
Motion has been made.
Second.
And seconded by Mr. Pierce. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Sorry, I always go to my left.
Mr. Chair.
Thank you very much. General business number three, Northeast Mass Mosquito and Wetlands Management District. Pardon me. It's now approaching 7:15, and we do have an appointment at 7:15 with Robert Gravino, Ipswich Raleigh Rotary, to discuss the September 11th, 2001 memorial. Mr. Gravino?
Okay. You normally need to come up to the front.
Right up the front there.
Mr. Perry and...
Mr. Gravino, before you go, proceed, I just want to declare that I'm a member of the Ipswich Rotary Club, and I've been a member for 6 years. I've served on their board, and also I'm past president. So in this matter, I will recuse myself from it. Thank you.
Okay, great. Mr. Perry and board, we're very honored to be here tonight. Thank you for having us. Sir, you've met the group out here. Keith Harris in the back is the co-owner, the owner of Partner with Choice, or Choice Graphics, here in Raleigh. Has been so you should probably recognize him.
Yes, I do.
Ray Katzen is an Ipswich resident. He is the secretary of the Ipswich Board of Directors. George Gray, sitting next to him, is another Ipswich resident who's the vice president. He'll be the president of the club in 2 years. And next person is Dave LaBelle. is a new member of Rotary who's one of our founders of our evening satellite club. We are forming a new club over there. And it's hopefully within a year or less, we should have a second Rotary club in Ipswich. What I'd like to do first is, you know, Rotarians love to give things away. And what I'd like to do is present you with a banner to the town and to the board. And we've put a pin on there. Every year, Rotary has got a theme, and this year's theme is Be a Gift to the World. And every year we have a different theme, and that's one of the kind of the mission's goals that we strive to do. Rotary Clubs, and I won't spend a lot of time talking about it, but Rotary is a service organization. It is not really a social organization where we come together to do good in the communities. And one of the reasons I'm here tonight is to just maybe open up a dialogue with the town. And what I'd like to ask the permission of the Board of Selectmen is that you grant us the ability to speak with your town administrator, with Debbie Egan, and that we have the ability to communicate with her, and where she feels it necessary that we need to come before the board, we would do so to get whatever kind of permission or to speak with you on any different issues. One of the things that we are looking to do very quickly is that we had a work party day, if you will, back in early June. It involved four local community projects in Ipswich and one in Raleigh. And the one here was your 9/11 memorial. And I was one of the five Rotarians who came over and worked on it. We were very impressed with the memorial. We didn't know that was actually in this town. When the group was done just cleaning it up and trimming and planting some flowers or whatever, we kind of as a group said that we thought that this memorial needed attention that we would be very interested in giving it. Having been Public Works in Ipswich, I know that it's very difficult to maintain a lot of the facilities and memorials and whatever in towns. So as a club, we would like to talk to you about someone adopting that and taking care of it year-round, and also maybe working with your community to have an appropriate 9/11 ceremony every year. Now, I know that Bob Halopian, if that's how you pronounce his name, has done something like that every year, and we'd like to join with him and have some kind of appropriate ceremony to honor those people who are on that airplane and make sure that we as a community, as a region, don't forget that great tragedy. So, interested in talking, and maybe that's something that you can grant authority to your town administrator to work on. She can give the feedback back to you on however basis, but we would like to start working in that direction. About a year ago, in honor of your, what was it, the 250, I believe.
375.
Oh, you're that old.
Time is flying.
Wow, that's right. 1639.
Bob was here at the original.
Yeah, he was. I can believe that. You know, we worked on the bandstand. That's another type project that we'd like to take on. So that's something I figure that we can talk with the town administrator on. And if I'm lucky, maybe I can convince her to become a Rotarian. But you didn't hear me say that. Also, it's kind of noted that the name of our club, it's the Rotary Club of Ipswich, Massachusetts. Raleigh is part of our service area, and we've had discussions, as long as I've been in the club now for about 7 or 8 years, of maybe changing that name to reflect the community of Raleigh, in which we have about a dozen members. My personal feeling is that I would like to see, after we get our evening club up and running, that we look into maybe talking with our Ipswich Rotarians who live in this community, not that we would like to see them leave our club, but to see what their thoughts are on maybe forming a club in this community. And since a lot of people in this community don't work here, commute to another location, maybe this would be another great site for an evening club. And I think that's, as a Rotarian, I would love to see Raleigh have its own Rotary Club. I think your culture and your just the history of your town, you deserve something of that nature. So that's kind of what we're here for. We're looking for projects to do in the community. We'd like to start off slowly. and make sure that we don't, you know, bite off more than we can chew, but we do want to start off with the 9/11 memorial, if you see that it's fit. We're looking for inputs from the community. As I say, we're a service organization, and that's what we want to do. And as I say, if you would give our board of directors or our leadership permission to communicate freely with your town administrator and work out dealings with her, I figure that she could be the relay between our club and you as a board to approve or to give suggestions or however back to our Rotary Club. Does anybody have any questions, comments? I'm not going to talk about Rotary. You can always ask Bob Snow or what's his name, Bob Mary, who is a longtime Rotarian also. And we are looking for members, so, you know, not to put any pressure on anybody. Everybody's smiling. They're not looking me in the eyes, but that's okay. but it is a good group. It is a commitment of both your personal time or resources, but everybody gives as to what they can afford. A lot of people, and that's why we're forming an evening club, because a lot of people don't have the time. They're not available to come to a morning club. They have children in school that they're getting off. They're commuting into Boston or another community. And it's we've got 10 members in our evening club. When we start to approach a total of 20 and they feel comfortable as a group, we will probably look to, I don't want to say spin them off, but to help them form their own club. Questions, comments, thoughts, or anything from the folks who have to listen to me all the time?
Just a comment that I would offer is that as chairman of the Raleigh 375 last year, we really appreciated your taking care of the bandstand for us and cleaning up that area. That were, because of our summer concert series, that worked out just beautifully.
Good.
And
good.
We really appreciated your service doing that.
Well, we'd like to be a part of your nice community, of because we are a part of your community. I'd like to leave you, if anybody's interested, in a Rotarian magazine, the most recent one. And I've also got some cards. I'll leave one for Bob Mary. I think I've already given one to the town administrator. Bob Snow, we have a club with five Bobs in it. That's why I'd love to get Bob's Mary into the club, because then we'd have six Bobs. Then we could take over the world.
Seems like all of them have been president, too.
Yeah, I don't know how that happens.
You have any?
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, I'd just like to congratulate you for coming over and making the offer of your group to get involved in Raleigh and what you've done in Raleigh already. I know Bob Snow speaks highly of some of the activities you've done, and I know you've worked on the gazebo, and I think this might be town like this, we have a lot of great citizens, but it's very hard to get people involved in volunteer projects and serve on committees and so on and so forth. And it sounds like an exciting opportunity to build some interest in giving back to the town from the variety of citizens that we have. And I think it's a great idea, and for you to work with our administrator and Reverend Agopian, and the fire chief I know is heavily involved in that memorial over there. They got the steel beam from the 9/11 building,
yeah,
so on and so forth. So it's an exciting opportunity, and I think we congratulate you on coming over and welcome you. And
very good.
Hopefully, we can be of help to you people in moving things forward in the town around.
But once again, we're a service organization. We're only here to do good in the community and other things. We also we've given two scholarships to two Raleigh students who go to Triton. They've already been before our club. They were here with us last week. And, that will continue.
No, it's great.
Well, thank you. And once again, it's not really me who's doing all this. It is the Rotary Club and its members. So I thank you for your time. And
Mr. Chairman, I'll make a motion that we accept the voluntary services of
Did
the Rotary
Club.
Did
you have any comment? Or?
No.
Okay. I'll
accept the voluntary services of the Ipswich
Second.
Club, and they work with our town administrator and officials to both take care of the memorial as well as future projects.
We have Mr. Pierce's second. All those in favor of the motion,
aye.
Say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you very much.
Thank you
Could I ask you one?
Sure.
Do you have a motto?
The club, service above self is the Rotary motto. Mine is just doing good in the world. I think all Rotarians have got one thing they kind of hang their hat on, but Rotary is service above self.
Very good. Thank you very much.
And you're also invited to any Rotary meeting that we ever have. You know, please talk to Bob, come as our guest. We'd love to show you who we are and what we do.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much for coming.
Oh, my pleasure.
Thank you very much.
Let's end. You got Bob.
Thank you, Bob.
That's my first name.
Thank you very much. Keith, good to see you again. I knew I recognized.
Keith, I know your mind is focused on the meeting, so. Thank you, David.
Take care, Ray. George. Dave.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Ray.
Thanks. Nice to meet you. Thank you.
Okay. On to general business number 3. Northeast Mass Mosquito and Wetlands Management District news release on the aerial application to control mosquito larvae on the coastal salt marshes. We have a letter to the Eagle Tribune Publishing, Bill Mahaffey, District Supervisor, dated July 7th, 2015. Please include the following press release. Press release, aerial application to control mosquito larvae on coastal salt marshes. The Northeast Massachusetts Mosquito Control and Wetlands Management District anticipates it may be necessary to conduct a helicopter application of the biological larvicide BTI to control mosquito larvae over coastal salt marshes in Salisbury, Newburyport, Newbury, Ipswich, and Raleigh during daylight hours between August 2nd, 2015 and August 15th, 2015. The material to be applied, BTI, Bacillus genesis and Var israelensis, wow, is a natural bacterium found in soil and water. BTI is a very selective larvicide which is non-toxic to people as well as fish, birds, bees, and to virtually all insect species. BTI only affects mosquito larvae and a few closely related aquatic insects in the fly family. The BTI will be applied by helicopter flying low directly over the salt marsh. The product name of the BTI is Vectobac 12AS, EPA registered number 73049-38. Excuse me. Residents need not take any special precautions excuse me, due to the safety of BTI and because the application will occur directly over the salt marsh in not residential areas. For further information, contact Bill Mahaffey, District Supervisor of the Northeast Massachusetts Mosquito Control and Wetlands Management District at 978-463-6630.
Mr. Chairman, you have trouble reading. I'll read some for you.
Thank you. Yeah, would you mind reading number 4?
Sure. Number 4, general business, Raleigh Water Department leaks detection program update. The Raleigh Water Department will begin a complete leak detection survey of 43 miles of water main in the distribution system beginning the week of August 5th, 2015. We have contacted the Water and Waste Pipe Testing Incorporated. We are required to perform this leak survey per the Water Management Act permit. The cost of the project is $6,300. By performing this survey, we will be saving the town thousands of dollars in lost revenue. from unaccounted for water leakage. The Water and Waste Pipe Testing Incorporated was established in April of 1981. It became a corporation in the state of Massachusetts in 1985. They provide service in numerous cities and municipalities in the New England area. Water and Waste Pipe Testing Incorporated has been a business for 33 years and have successfully performed well over 800 water leakage surveys. For more information, please contact the Raleigh Water Department at 978-948-2640.
I think this is a very important survey to take, that we do have some thousands of gallons of water leaking. And we do have to find out where the leaks are and do what we can to do something about the water leakage. Any comment? Comment?
Oh, no.
Okay. Time being a little after 7:30, we will go on to our second appointment, 7:30, Conservation Agent Brent Baselak, to discuss request to block the swing gate bypass at Smith Lane entrance at Harris Park. Brent?
Thank you, Chairman Perry and members of the Board of Selectmen. submitted a request upon discovery that the metal swing gate that provides emergency vehicle access to the Smith Lane entrance, which also has a telecommunications tower and goes into at least now, I believe, three, if not four, conservation parcels, has effectively had apparently motorized vehicle a bypass, I guess, is the best word. They've driven up onto the sand embankment to the east of the gate and established a pathway that apparently is used on a regular basis by the landscape firm that maintains the ball fields. But unfortunately, it also provides then access to any two-axled motorized transport, such as an ATV or RV or motorized trail bikes, to also gain access into that corridor, which is not actively managed or maintained, nor is the trail system appropriately upgraded for motorized vehicles to be utilizing it, as well as the Conservation Commission believes that there would be a conflict with the other planned uses, such as hikers, pedal bikers, horseback riding, and other passive recreational activities that the Commission hopes to enhance and allow for utilization of the recently acquired conservation property. Also, the issue of possible liability. There's the issue of emergency access, which is provided by the gate, but the problem is, since there's a large acreage that isn't necessarily viewed or has anyone out there on a regular basis, it is possible that an accident could occur with a motorized vehicle, that one wouldn't discover that a person has been injured until, you know, possibly long after, when help would have been effective. Not trying to be a fearmonger or anything, but it's just the lack of ability to appropriately manage for motorized transport into that area. So since the Harris Park recreation area, we believe, is under the care and custody of the Board of Selectmen, we are hereby making a request that we place boulders or some other natural material only for blocking this particular bypass to the east of the metal gate. I have also contacted Tim Suthall, representing Parks and Rec Committee. He indicated that he had no objections to this pursuit.
There's only a bypass to one side of the gate?
That is correct. Yeah, there's logs and boulders situated, plus I think that's also where they, at this time of year, they have the batting, pitching cages erected, so there's kind of netting that would catch them. As well as the ball field itself is fenced in.
You have any comment?
Oh, sounds like a good idea.
Good idea.
Now, you say the person that cuts the ball field grass uses that bypass?
Only because I talked to them at one point in time, and as far as I know, they have been given the ability to open the gate. Plus, they could easily go to the police department, who also has a key available when they needed to. But again, that's not... My particular department does not supervise the contractor who has the responsibility for maintaining the ball fields and supposedly provisions for them to be able to open and close the gate has been previously made, I think. But again, I may be speaking out of turn. But
I think, Mr. Chairman, that I was over at the conservation office today on a different matter and talked with Mr. Baselak. There's a potential for some more trails to be opened up over at the conservation area, formerly known as the Girl Scout property, and I think it's critical that we deny motorized access as best we can. Obviously, we can't stop everything, but I would like to see us, give permission for whomever. Who would do that? Probably the highway department?
Well, I've actually been in contact since presently our chairman, Arthur Page, is also on the cemetery commission. He informed me that he believed he had one or two boulders of sufficient heft and weight that could be placed there. Now, I imagine I would have to be coordinating with the highway department, our surveyor, Patrick Snow, has been very accommodating and provided a lot of assistance in this effort. And it's mostly in the interest of public safety and appropriately managing that suite of properties that's accessible through there.
So I would suggest that we authorize the Conservation Commission to contact whatever board is necessary in hopes that they'll give assistance. Also, it might be worthwhile to have a letter sent to the Recreation Commission, so it's a little more formal, for them to notify their landscape person that if they need to access that back property, they need to do it properly through the gate.
To secure the block, the bypass.
Yeah, in other words, we're not trying to, if they need to get back there for some reason, that's fine. Mm-hmm. Anybody that needs to get back there can get, like you say, Brent, they can get authorization, but we definitely, as that property gets push forward on the conservation levels and with a lot of other activities going on out there, we really want to discourage motorized vehicles and whatever you can do to block that access, or I would say if you see other accesses, other avenues of pass that are being opened, that you go ahead and I don't think this board has any problem of authorizing you to, give a call to the town administrator. We're more than happy to work it out, because it's a valuable piece of property. It's going to only get more use over time. And right. Down the other end, you got the Y Camp, who often, I'm sure, is using that property during the week for hikes and trail watches, and you're going to have some people down there cutting trails and things like that. So I think it's important that access be granted to those that want to use it on a conservation, recreation type basis, but not we're not looking for motorized vehicles to be down there.
Well, again, in this particular situation, this is precautionary. I'm not aware at any point in time that we have had motorized transport in there. And two, it's just depends upon the appropriate management and the idea that, first off, there's a safety and liability issue, and that's primary in the concern here. But thirdly, the kind of uses that we wish to facilitate and have enjoy the property would not necessarily be compatible, and plus the fact that it recently has been opened, and I thank you very much for your support and your acknowledgement of the volunteer effort out there, and I hope in a very short time to be back before you in support of a Boy Scout who has an Eagle Service project that we're working on right now, and I'm hoping also to be asking you for the placement of a sign in this same location, directing folks to the existence of Smith Lane, since from the amount of stares I get when I come out with my vehicle from working on the trail and the ball games going on, I think there's a lot of people that just aren't aware at all.
I would bet
that that's the
unfortunately
access trail now to conservation lands.
I think it will change.
I did, just for the information of the board, I did, when I went over to see Mr. Baselak today, one of my concerns was the entrance to Smith Lane off of Weathersfield Street.
Right.
And we went out, we met out there with the highway surveyor, and Bob Murray and myself, and talked about a four, five, six car parking area over there, and then the old Smith Lane would be the access to a walking access, not a motor vehicle access, but a walking access to that property. And I really want to move forward on that project. So what I do see the director of the Ipswich Y on at the diner on a regular basis, and I asked Brent if we could go out there and the sooner rather than later to at least mark or delineate clearly with and look at what signage would be needed so that people could at this point at least be able to walk in from Weathersfield Street and know that where they're going is the correct path and that the camp is familiar with that and is in agreement with us that that's an appropriate spot. Eventually we may need to put up some, you know, some trail markings. I'm not sure what's required. And then after Labor Day, we'll take a look at actually cleaning out an area there where the vehicles can park. But I would like to, you know, just let you know that I'm hoping next 2 weeks to walk that area and put some signage up, because we've had some inquiries from neighbors as well as citizens who are anxious to be able to take a walk up there. And we've, you know,
there are actually two no trespassing signs. I think they were put up by the Girl Scouts years ago.
Probably.
At the entrance to Smith Lane, and one on each side. So that may be sending the wrong message to people, you know, about who owns that property and what it could be used for.
Right.
They are appropriately camouflaged with very lush poison ivy.
Yes.
I had a site visit out on Outer Weathersfield Street today and stopped and documented that end of Smith Lane in anticipation of having a discussion about it.
Mm-hmm. But, I understand the goats were out there.
Well, you'd have to be a really tall goat to take care of this particular camouflage.
Goats love poison ivy.
Yes, they do.
I guess the Y hired some goats.
Yes. I know that I've driven by personally several times, and that it's an area, you know, I'd like to visit, and with the signage, it would be more visible and easier to access.
Right, right.
And it's important, I think, too. I mean, the Y is put in, as I understand it, close to $100,000 at this point into those buildings and fixing up the camp area, which is one reason why we wanted to lease it to an organization like that. So they're really doing a lot of work over there, and they're very excited about other projects, and I just want to make sure that they're in agreement with us how we delineate the area. And
right.
We obviously don't want to interfere with the camp operation and things they have going on, and they want to be as accommodating as they can to our needs for the people, the public, to use that trail to access that property. And as you said, Brent, in the past, we're really looking for people to access it from the Harris Park side, but you know, two or three or four parking spaces or whatever, so people can access it from the Weathersfield Street side, as well as the neighbors and stuff is a great way to go in and just take a short hike and mm-hmm. so on and so forth. So,
did you make a motion on?
No, I just okay. I'm just informing you that, you know, in case anybody has any objections, that we're going to take a look at that, and then after Labor Day, I would assume we'll be coming back with a motion for permission to actually construct
a motion to block the bypass.
I'll give you a motion to block
I'll
the bypass and whatever it takes.
Bob Snow second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Appreciate
your
consideration.
You're
doing a great job. Well, that and all the other conservation properties.
Yeah, appreciate your support.
Thank you, Brett.
Is there anything else I may be of service to the Board of Selectmen this evening?
I think we're all set.
I think we're good.
Thank you.
Thank you, Brent, again.
Golly, I'm on time.
You're doing good here.
You're good.
We have an appointment at 7:45 p.m. with Travis Nealon to discuss shellfish constable position. Travis, would you come up front, please?
You want me to sit, stand?
Sure.
Please. Okay. Be with me for a moment.
Yep.
Travis is an applicant for the position of shellfish constable. He met with Chairman Bob Murray and Debbie on July 27th. They discussed the requirements of the shellfish constable position and bylaw requirements. He is interested in this position. Travis is a student at Salem State University. Great place. Majoring in criminal justice, Travis has extensive clamming and boating experience and currently works for his family's shellfish business, which is based in Raleigh. He has a thorough knowledge of the town's waterways and clam flats. The Corey background check has been completed. Can you tell me, Travis, why are you interested in this position?
Just shellfish clamming is just something that's always been in the family. Just grew up with it. And obviously I'm interested in criminal justice, and I know, I don't know if it's a form of it, but I know, I just thought it'd be something fun to do. I know the old constables, they're cousins as well, their family, and I know they took pride in it, and I just thought, why not? So, I mean, I've been clam digging my whole life, and it's one thing my dad has put in my mind is don't let other people dig your own clams. So I know I've dealt with plenty of Ipswich guys, plenty of Newbury guys. So, yeah.
It seems like from the stories that I've heard on the board here that we've had several incursions from fellas from Ipswich primarily, but maybe Newbury also.
I believe last week my father and I went down, and right in the middle ground there was two Ipswich guys razor clamming, and I didn't recognize the boat, so I brought it up. I said, do you know those guys? He said, no, let's swing over. And there were two Ipswich guys, and he said he used to be the old constable ways back, and he showed me what to do. It was just small talk, and he just kicked them off the flat. So.
And
they left, yeah, no arguments, nothing. Just.
Well, that's a positive aspect. Anybody else with a question?
How's your knowledge are the locations of the town's various clam flats? Well, you've been doing this for a long time, so you know.
Yeah, I know pretty much everywhere, yeah.
So you know the delineation line between Ipswich and Raleigh?
Yep. Yeah. And Newbury is just the tires on the horseshoe, and I know from what I believe, you take those tires and you line them up on the Plum Island Bank, and I know there's an area in Raleigh, an area in Newbury. And, Mud Ditch is partial Newbury, partial Raleigh. So
you've been using boats since you were real young.
Oh yeah, I know. There's an old newspaper article. I must have been 5 years old. It's my dad and some other people, and they're helping the seed. They're planting seeds on flats, and it was in the paper. So I've been doing it since I was in diapers, pretty much.
Wow. Okay. Just to make a comment, the reason why I commented about Salem State University is that I'm a graduate.
Awesome.
Obviously, and we just celebrated our 50th anniversary last year. Please tell us about your studies at Salem State.
I'm going into my junior year as a criminal justice major. I believe I have most of my basic classes out of the way, math and English. Taking a few business classes, but mostly just focused on criminal justice. I know mostly what they teach there is just a broad view of the field, because it's a big field. So I've been just, it's a lot of introduction classes is what I do there.
Very good.
Just, you're young, I'm glad to see you getting involved, yeah. And obviously the history of your family has got a long history in Raleigh, and we thank you and your family for that, and we really thank you for volunteering to take over this position. The whole shellfish situation seems to be in kind of a disarray as a result of recent actions, so you're the first one to step forward.
Yeah.
Do you have other people you think might be willing to get involved and be part of the new era in Raleigh for both shellfish commissioners and shellfish assistant constables and things like that?
My dad told me there's a few people, and I've talked to a few people. I don't know if you want names or not. Or
no, I don't know. I'm just saying that we're looking at this down the road a piece once you get acclimated and stuff like that.
Okay.
You know. In other words, I know nothing about clamming. I lived in Raleigh a lot of years, but it's not my cup of tea.
No.
But certainly it sounds like from the stories we've been told and the issues involved that if we don't have a constable out there, that our clam flats are going to be overrun by out-of-towners from Ipswich, Newbury, Gloucester, who knows where they come from. So it's an important position, a very responsible position. And being a young man, it sounds like you've got some... you're very much interested. You have family that can make suggestions and help you out making decisions. And I look forward to. It'd be nice to have some new blood.
Thank you.
And leave it at that.
This responsibility has a revolving fund budget, and it has approximately $5,000. Do you have any experience with budgets?
Not really. I put my money in the bank. As much as I know, yeah.
That's a good sign.
Yeah.
Yes.
I don't like spending. But I just, not much, no, but I don't.
One thing that we will offer you if you're appointed is that you could work with Mrs. Egan and to prepare the fiscal budgets.
Yep.
So that you'll be able to handle that. I think you'll pick it up real quickly if you can do the work at Selwyn State. Anybody else with a question?
I have a question. I guess as the shellfish constable, you would be responsible for enforcing pertinent state laws and regulations.
Yep.
Are you familiar with those?
I've been looking them over the past few nights. Yeah, I've read them, and I think I have an idea of it.
And your family's business, do they harvest clams from in Raleigh?
Personally, our family does it, and they purchase clams from the clam diggers themselves and then process them and deliver them to restaurants.
So do you think you'd be able to apply the rules, enforce the rules fairly to everyone, including your family members?
Definitely, yeah.
Anybody else?
No.
I would just suggest that you're probably familiar with Bill Demento, the harbor master, and you can work with him, and I'm sure he's more than happy to help you out, too, with budgeting as well as a town administrator. So I think there's a lot of help out there for you. It sounds like there's a lot of resources available.
Yeah, I appreciate it.
Sounds like you're interested, and it's not $1 million budget, so budgeting is not a huge issue. In fact, if anything, we've well underfunded the shellfish budget for years, and it's one of those things we need to take a look at. But no, I have no further questions. I think he seems like a very talented young man, and we would welcome the town service.
The position requires ethics tests, correct?
It will be required, as every town employee and official needs to take the online state ethics test. And I think we would also need to contact the State Ethics Commission and get any guidelines that would be necessary for Travis if he's appointed, that he would need to follow with respect to his family's business.
You may have to file a disclosure.
Also. We have had other situations where we have departments where there are family members involved, and we've called the State Ethics Commission. We have disclosures on file and procedures that are followed.
Right.
And knowing that we do have deputy constables on staff, and what I'm guessing the State Ethics Commission would probably advise us is that a deputy shellfish commissioner would handle any enforcement issues or the processing of any clamming permits related to the Nealon family business, and that Travis would be not involved in that. So it turned over to a deputy so that there'd be no conflict of interest.
Right.
Yeah, one thing I would emphasize again is that we have a lot of resources available.
Yeah.
And don't hesitate. If you have a question, come to us and, you know, ask your questions. Anybody else?
I like this applicant. I'll give you a motion to for him become constable.
Okay. Motion has been made.
Second.
Second by Mr. Pierce. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Welcome aboard.
Thank you.
Welcome, glad to have you on board. Good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for stepping up.
Thank you.
Nice meeting. Keep studying.
Yeah.
Yep. Don't let the flames push you out of
the Do you need to stick around? Or?
Nope. You can. No. I would contact the town administrator or Amy tomorrow, and they can fill you in on what you need to do.
Right. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Travis.
Okay, we're off to new business. We have a letter from the Municipal Lighting Plant, Town of Raleigh, Board of Selectmen. Board, P.O. Box 275, 139 Main Street, Raleigh, Mass. Lighting of the Civil War Monument. Dear Board of Selectmen, per the Board of Light Commissioners at their meeting on August 5th, 2015, they have asked that the Civil War Monument in the Town Common be illuminated at night. This is an important part of the community, and the commissioners felt it would be important to light the monument. The Raleigh Light Department will donate labor and material in order to light the monument. I would ask that the selectmen approve the lighting of the monument and the kilowatt usage for the lights be added to the town street lighting bill. Sincerely, Dan Folding, General Manager, Raleigh Municipal Light Plant.
I give you a motion, Mr. Chairman. It's a worthwhile project.
We have a motion?
I recuse myself because I'm a light commissioner.
I'd like to make a point or a question, really. There's no details in the letter about the nature of the lighting. I mean, I just would hope it's not something that is going to create a glare for either motorists or people who live around the common. But, you know, in general, I think it's a good idea as long as it's done appropriately. I guess we would...
Would you add that?
We'll incorporate that into the...
Be sensitive to it, you know, to that goal.
Right.
Not lighting up the sky for, you know...
Yeah, no, I'd be more than happy to incorporate that into my motion.
Yeah,
that
okay.
The lighting be appropriate to avoid glare.
Yeah. On that basis, I'll second it then.
Motion has been made and seconded to approve the lighting of the Civil War Monument. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Mr. Snow recuses.
I recuse myself.
Okay, new business number two. We have a stable permit application from Sandra Hamill for 27 Main Street. Sandra Hamill has submitted an application for a stable license at 27 Main Street for 2 to 5 horses. Animal Inspector Reed Wilson has spoken to her and visited the site and has no issues or concerns. Wilson reported that the horses are not there yet, but are expected in a few weeks to a month. And there is a shelter set up and an area fenced in. All light, water, and tax bills are up to date. The application seems to be in order.
Give me that motion, Mr. Chairman.
Second.
Motion has been made and seconded. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. New business number three. Discuss town common tree maintenance. Steve Harrison, a member of the Town Common Restoration Committee, reported last week to Amy that the trees planted on the Town Common need water. He said that the water geater bags will not work and that the trees need to be watered in a 10-foot diameter at least one time per week. Since the town has an outside watering ban in place, tree warden Patrick Snow told Debbie that he has left a message with Water Superintendent Mary Beth Weiser, asking if he can use the tree department's tank truck to water the trees on the town common. Patrick has asked Superintendent Weiser if it will be permissible to water the trees from the tank during the water ban. He is waiting for confirmation from the water superintendent, Mary Beth Weiser, on whether this will be permissible. Quite a number of trees for a 10-foot radius.
Well, I imagine the gator bags are only good for young trees, but now that the things are getting established, it probably, you know, when they say it doesn't work, it probably doesn't cover a big enough area, I would imagine.
Right, and we did have our first concert, and I noticed that the gator bags are gone.
Oh, they are, yeah.
I noticed the other day, I stopped by the water, the highway department earlier in the week, early last week, because a couple of those trees are starting to look really dry.
Oh, yes.
So I would suggest that you know, if we don't put some water on them, we're going to lose them.
Yeah. Well, we may get a lot of water tomorrow. But
well, we'll get some, but I mean, at least if we can suggest that the highway department, I know I realize there's a water ban on, but we've got a lot of money invested
sure.
in those trees out there.
Yeah.
Well, the ban is from 9
I don't think they're guaranteed anymore.
Probably
I think the guarantee is ran out.
9 to 5
If we lose them, maybe we can get the, you know, for the, go to Newbury and get some water. Or Ipswich. And water, there's probably 3 or 4 that I noticed that are looking like they could really use some water. Not, wouldn't have to do all of them until we get permission. But, I mean, in fact, to do all of them is going to be quite a project anyway. Mm-hmm. But in the meantime, if we could get some water at the base, at least at the base of those 2 or 3 or 4 that are, we've started to drop leaves already. Mm. That would be really helpful, and hopefully, the weather's going to turn around. We get some heavy, supposed to be some heavy rain tomorrow, and maybe, you know, going forward there'd be more rain. But I just hate to see us lose. The trees look really nice out there.
Yeah,
they do.
I hate to lose them. And,
the water ban is between what
9 and 9 to 5
9 to 5 So
it's a staffing issue.
Staffing issue
with the.
Well, we have to pay overtime. I think it's what small amount we need to pay the highway overtime to go out there, you know, one night a week or something, at least for now, for an emergency basis, to put some water. We're going to save money because I don't know what.
Or in the morning.
I mean,
well, if he has the tank truck, it's not an issue. If he can, like, you know, use the water.
If we get the water tank truck,
but,
and fill it.
And if he uses the distribution system. The connection draws the hose out. You know, he would have to do that before 9, and I know that the highway crews do start earlier before then, so maybe they could do it before.
Yeah, they start at 7, I believe, during the summer.
Before the 9 o'clock.
Yeah, get them out early on the common.
But I would suggest that we, you know, I'd make a motion to advise Pat to put some water, you know, to use his best judgment. He's the tree warden, but put some water right away on an emergency basis on the ones that look tough over there. And then depending on how the weather goes, we may have to follow up with more, but at least to try and, because once they start going, it's tough to save them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Once they get damaged, it's difficult. So hopefully we're not too late already.
Right. That's very important that I hope we're not too late.
Yeah, I don't think we got any time to waste, you know.
David made a motion.
Second.
No.
Second. Thank you.
Mr. Pierce has seconded the motion. All those in favor, say aye.
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 Yeah, I think it's important that we do make an effort to save the trees.
It's
There's quite an investment out there.
The common looks great. And
okay, the next item on the agenda is the minutes from July 27th, 2015. Has everybody had a chance to read the minutes?
Yes.
Yes.
I'll give you a motion, Mr. Chairman.
I saw one. I believe on page 5, the discussion on Karen Tyler. In that paragraph, be the second sentence, where it says, she said that was in basic training. I think it should be, she said that she was in basic training during 9/11. So the word she is should be inserted.
Yes.
Hmm.
Yeah, that's right.
With the correction?
With the correction, I'll make that motion.
I'll second it.
Mr. Peterson, second. All those in favor of accepting the minutes for July 27th, 2015, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, we are at the announcements. It's going to be less than 2 weeks, the Raleigh Concert on the Common. On Sunday, August 23rd, 2015, from 4 to 6 p.m., featuring the Senior Tones. And we hope that we get a big crowd for the Senior Tones on Sunday, August 23rd, 2015, from 4 to 6 p.m.
Can I give you a plug for the Senior Tones?
Absolutely.
They are great. I've seen them like 3 or 4 times. They're a lot of fun. Come and see the Senior Tones. You'll have a good time. It'll be a good night on the Common.
I agree with you 100%. The town has the following vacancies. Conservation Commission, 1 seat. Shellfish Commissioners, 2 seats. Cable Advisory Committee, seeking 5 members. Fence Viewer, 3 positions. Wood, Lumber, and Bark Inspector, and Zoning Board of Appeals Associate, 2 seats. Historic Commission, Historic District Commission, 2 seats. Parks and Recreation Committee, 2 seats. Open Space Committee is seeking 2 members. For more information on these positions, please contact the Selectmen's office at 948-2372. The Raleigh Food Pantry is in need of donations. Summertime more than ever. The Food Pantry is open Tuesdays from 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. and Thursdays from 5:30 p.m. to 7 p.m. The Raleigh Public Library is offering discounts to Lowell Spinners baseball games. For more information, contact the Raleigh Public Library at 978-948-2850. The Raleigh Community Blood Drive, Monday, August 31st, 2015, from 2 p.m. to 7 p.m. at the Raleigh Veterans Association, 19 Bradford Street. The Raleigh Chili Cook-Off will be held on Saturday, September 26th, 2015, from 2 p.m. to dusk, and the new venue will be on the Town Common under the tent, and you will look for a honorary judge to be there on Saturday, September 26th.
Probably looking for the vice chair.
Vice chair. With his sombrero on. If he can get it from his nephew. Well, we have one more motion to make.
I'll make that motion to adjourn, Mr. Chairman.
Second.
All those in favor of adjourning, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Thank you very much.
It's been 2 weeks, right?